sing, sing hallelujah. For joy awakes as morning light, when Christ's disciples lift their eyes. Alive he stands, their friend and king, Christ, Christ is risen.
Could be. Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved. Buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified. despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is here. Hands that heal nations, stretched out on a tree, and took the nails for me. He's living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. And buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming on glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
One day the grave could conceal Him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then He arose over death He had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord, evermore.
Death could not hold Him. The grave could not.
Crown Him grave, who rose victorious through the strife for those he came to save. His glory is now we see, who died and rose on high, who died.
Messiah, hold forever those above, displayed on the cross, lifted up.
Lifted up was he to die. It is finished, was his cry. But now in heaven he's lifted high. Hallelujah,
what a Savior.
And when he comes, our glorious King,
yes,
all his ransom home to bring, then anew this song will say, hallelujah, hallelujah, what a Savior, oh, hallelujah, and praise to
open paradise. Hallelujah. Christ has led.
Hallelujah.
Bowing our exalted head.
Hi, I'm Chad, the lead pastor of Christ Community Church, and I want to welcome you to our online Easter service. I'm joined today by my family.
I'm Carrie.
I'm Turner.
And I'm Kate.
We miss seeing you guys today, but we hope that you're safe at home, and we're so thankful that we can still get dressed up in our Easter best and have an Easter service with you online.
Happy Easter. We miss you.
Happy Easter.
We're so sad that we're not all together today at 4050 Colonial Boulevard, but know that we're thinking about each and every one of you. We miss our annual Easter breakfast and our Easter egg hunt and all the festivities that we would normally have, but we're praying that you have an extra safe Easter at your home, and we are praying that you are enjoying the day and making great memories with your family over either a yummy breakfast or a delicious lunch, celebrating what today really means and the excitement that it brings for our future.
We're going to get started with our Easter service. We hope this is a blessing to you today. And remember, Christ is risen.
It's been 3 days. I can still see the pain, the strain, the blood that drained that day. Calvary. They pierced his hands, his feet, for all to see this man, this king, this Jesus. This tangible passion, this relentless abandon, this love, this hope was gone. Jesus wasn't finished yet. Today the stone's been rolled away. The grave has lost its claim of victory. Death has given way to life, to grace. Our sin replaced, erased by mercy. Hope is alive. Mercy can thrive, revive, bring to life the hearts of men. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. He didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What can separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal. God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone. Weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord. scenes to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
He shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone. Faultless I stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love.
Good morning, Christ Community, church, family, and friends. We are so thankful that you are here again with us today. We have a few announcements for you. The first announcement is Kids World will be starting in just a few minutes. Parents, please make sure you check your email for the safe and secure website and login code. We have provided a safe place for your kids to worship today. And my kids had a great time last week. It was so fun for them to see familiar faces that they've been missing from Kids World. So please log in just a few minutes and partake in that. If you did not receive a code or you're just finding out about us, please email the office and they'll get you started for next week. But it is a safe and secure location, so we can't just add anybody at the last minute. Secondly, renovations are happening at CCC. We are so excited about them. I got a sneak peek just the other day, and it looks so awesome. We cannot wait for you to see it. Thank you for each and every gift that has been given towards the renovation. We are so appreciative. Remember, if you would like to continue giving to CCC, you can do that either the mail or the website. We are still receiving donations that way, whether for your normal offering or for the renovation. Thank you. We really appreciate it. And again, if you need to give your regular tithe, the office is checking the mail regularly, so you can send it in the mail or on the website. Also, all of our regular programming is happening online, so please make sure to check your email or contact the office, and they'll be happy to help you with anything that you need.
Lastly, after Pastor Chad preaches, we're going to have a conversation on Facebook Live. So please stick around, join us, and we're going to talk about his message and talk about things happening at CCC. And we might even talk about your outfit. Thank you again for joining us today at CCC. We miss you so much.
Hey everybody, Pastor Chad here with a renovation 2020 update. Things have been going very well with our renovation. We are overhauling our parking lot, our outdoor rotunda, and our family life center. We want to redo our outdoor rotunda to completely replace the roof and redo the outdoor space with a new courtyard. The roof has been coming along really well. We had all the carpentry work done last week, and this week the roofers came in and are putting in a brand new roofing system for that rotunda, and then we'll get started making that middle area a nice paved courtyard. This should all be done sometime within the next few weeks so that we can have it looking like these beautiful renderings and make the outside of our property a very appealing space. Inside, we're redoing the entire Family Life Center. We have had a ton of progress. This is in the youth room, a new cafe area. We've gotten the dividers out. Lots of framing has gone in for restructuring and adding in new classrooms. We're very excited for our classrooms to be modern and nice and clean looking. Of course, the gym is a big project. We want our gym to be not only nice and open and looking beautiful, but safe for our kids. You can see here that we've got the ceiling blacked out, some of that new light gray color in. Over 10,000 square feet of flooring showed up this week. We've got the hallway framed out for the kids area. That's the underlayment there that you're looking at in the hallway for the vinyl flooring. We can't wait for that space in the next few weeks to be transformed to look more like these gorgeous renderings. Of course, we're also paying attention to our bathrooms, completely overhauling the men's and women's bathrooms. And we've gotten most of it demoed. Some of the plumbing fixtures still need to come out. But that's all coming along very well. And we think in the next few weeks, we'll have these bathrooms completely renovated as well. So as you can see, a lot going on with our renovation 2020. I want to thank you so much for your generous giving and support for this project. And I can't wait till we can all be back together again and see it completed. Let's continue with our worship as we prepare our hearts for the message. I want to tell you the most extreme story of social distancing that anyone has ever experienced and lived to tell about it. It's about a man who lived during the time of Jesus. And while he didn't experience a global health pandemic, he did experience a severe illness that threatened his life. And so as this man, whose name was Lazarus, got more and more sick, his friends and family sent for Jesus. You see, today we're panicked by the idea that we might run out of essential medical supplies, but the friends and family of Lazarus understood that Jesus' healing power would never run out. And so after they sent word to Jesus, they waited. They waited for him to show up and heal their brother and friend. Or they waited one day for Lazarus to just miraculously sit up in his bed, completely healed, and they would know that Jesus from a distance had spoken the word and healed their brother. But that visit never came. That moment of healing didn't happen. In fact, as Lazarus deteriorated and got more and more sick, his friends and family watched helplessly as he died. Several days later, when the mourners gathered and the funeral began, Mary and Martha got word that Jesus had arrived. They never even imagined that Jesus would be attending their brother's funeral. They never imagined that their brother would get to the point of death. And so in their grief and their frustration, they poured their heart out to Jesus. Jesus listened. He entered into their grief. He empathized and he gave this promise. From John chapter 11, verse 23, he said to Martha, "Your brother will rise again." Now, Martha interpreted Jesus' words as a nice gesture, kind of like, "You'll see your brother one day in heaven," something that people often say at a funeral or in a time of grief. But Jesus clarifies, and in verse 25, he says to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though they die, yet shall they live." And Martha, although she still didn't fully understand, she professes her faith in Jesus as the Christ. And so Jesus, entering into the grief of his friends, weeps with them. He's angered at sin and the death that it produces, the sin and death that he had come to defeat. And so at the objection of the mourners, he has them roll the stone away. And he says these words, "Lazarus, come out." And at that moment, Lazarus's quarantine was over. His extreme social distancing was ended. He came out of the tomb in his grave clothes, alive at the command of Jesus. Today on Easter Sunday, Jesus is saying to us, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though they die, yet shall they live." Easter is a day when Christians all around the world proclaim Jesus as our living hope. Would you pray with me? Father, we want to thank you for this opportunity today to worship you. It is unusual circumstances. Father, I confess, it feels very strange to be preaching into a camera, to not be gathered with my brothers and sisters in person. And yet, Lord, we know that you are in control. We want to love our neighbors. We want to do our part to keep people safe. And so, Lord, we look to you, our living hope, and we wait for the day when we can safely gather together for worship again. And in our waiting, as Lazarus waited in that tomb, we look to you. We believe in you as the resurrection and the life. And so we pray in the midst of these difficult times that you would give us your living hope. Jesus, we pray this in your name. Amen. The main point of the message today is that Jesus is our living hope. Jesus is our living hope. If you have a Bible, turn to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. If you don't have a physical Bible, use a different device than what you're using to watch this message, and open up the YouVersion website, bible.org, or you can open up the YouVersion Bible app on your smartphone or tablet device. You'll find a live event where you can find the outline and all the scriptures, and you can follow along. We're going to begin in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 8. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 8. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then Jesus appeared to James, then to all the apostles, last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me. Jesus is our living hope. And the first point that we're going to see from 1 Corinthians 15 is that the gospel is a matter of faith and fact. The gospel is a matter of faith and fact. Verses 1 through 2 remind us of the vital importance of the gospel message. Paul tells us that it is the message by which we are being saved. The gospel is the good news that Jesus lived the perfect life that we could never live, that he died on the cross to pay the price for sin that you and I should have to pay. And this is the part where Easter comes in, that God raised him from the dead so that when we place our faith in him, we can be brought from death to life and have new life in him. This is a message of faith that is of vital importance. But there are many messages of faith in our world today. There are many different religions. Many people have different opinions about how to relate to God. And so the Apostle Paul reminds us that the gospel is not just a matter of faith, it's also a matter of fact. The gospel is not just something that we believe in, it is something that is historically true. Now you might wonder, Pastor Chad, how could you say that the gospel, especially the resurrection, how could you say that this is a matter of historical fact or historical record? I mean, isn't the resurrection a teaching in the Bible? Isn't the Bible a book of religious beliefs? That's an unfortunate misunderstanding about the nature of the Bible. You see, the Bible is certainly God's word. The Bible certainly does contain many spiritual truths, but the Bible is also the historical record of the people of God, of the words they received from God, of the ways they related to God. In fact, non-Christians, historians who are skeptical of Christianity, they accept that the Bible is a historically accurate record of events. And this is no different when it comes to the gospel. And let me make it a little clearer and make a statement that might seem a little bit extreme to you, but I want to make it very simply so that you could quickly fact check this statement. You could quickly see if it's true or not. Once this pandemic is over, if you'd like to talk about it over coffee, I'd love to get together. But let me make this statement, and then I'd like to support it with a few points. The statement is this. Again, the gospel is a matter of faith and fact. And here's the part about the fact. The vast majority of the best historical scholars agree that Jesus is a real person who lived in history, died by crucifixion, and was seen by his closest followers shortly after his burial. Let me repeat that. The vast majority of the best historical scholars agree that Jesus was a real person who lived in history, who died by crucifixion, and who was seen by his closest followers shortly after his burial. Now, you might hear that and say, Pastor Chad, how could you possibly make a statement like that about a religious claim like the resurrection of Jesus. There's a scholar named Gary Habermas. He's a historian who specializes in the resurrection. And I want to present to you what he says to support this claim that the vast majority of the best historical scholars believe that the gospel is a matter of historical record, that Jesus was a real person who lived in history. He died on the cross and he was seen by his closest followers shortly after his burial. And Habermas begins with other historical truth claims. For example, how do we know that George Washington was a real person in history? I've never met George Washington. You've never met George Washington. Even your great-grandparent never met George Washington. There are no videos of George Washington. There's no audio of George Washington. So how do we know that he was a real person? How do we know what he said and did? It's because we have the record of people, second, third, fourth, fifth hand, who wrote about George Washington. There are many people who saw him for themselves and wrote down what he did and what he said. And we consider these to be reliable sources. And so we believe that George Washington is a real person who lived in history. We believe the cumulative account of his life. And it's no different with other figures in history. And it's no different with Jesus, although he lived much earlier than George Washington. In fact, there are over 12 different independent sources outside of the Bible that talk about Jesus. But historians, and I'm talking about non-Christian historians, even skeptics agree that the contents of the Bible contain historical facts. And so the Gospels and the writings of the Apostle Paul also count as historical records of the life of Jesus. Now, one of the questions that we have to ask when we think about historical record is how long after the events of a person's life were the events of their life written? And so when we're talking about skeptical scholars, non-Christians who are pretty conservative in their estimates, they would say that the Gospel of John, for example, was probably written in 95 AD. That's 65 years after the death of Jesus. But they believe that Matthew and Luke were written a little earlier than that, maybe 85 AD. So now we're about 55 years after the death of Jesus. Mark's gospel, they say, is written even earlier, probably at like 40 AD. And so 70 AD. And so Mark's gospel is only 40 years after the life of Jesus. Now you might hear that and say, wait a minute, 40 years, that's a long time. I turned 40 last year. That's my whole life. We have to think about this in terms of historians, not lay people like me or like you. So let's think of another historical figure that's relatively uncontroversial, somebody like Tiberius Caesar. Tiberius Caesar died in 37 AD. The earliest historical record we have for Tiberius Caesar is 125 years later. Now think about that in comparison with the 40-year gap between the death of Jesus and his appearance to his disciples and the first gospel, the Gospel of Mark, and that 40 years starts to seem a lot better when you consider that it was 125 years after the life of Tiberius Caesar before we have the first historical record. But remember, it's not just the Gospels that gives us historical information about Jesus' life. It's also the letters of the Apostle Paul. In fact, this letter to the Corinthians, historians agree, was written sometime around 55 AD. 55 AD. That means it was only 25 years after the death of Jesus and his appearance to his closest followers. But I want you to notice something that the Apostle Paul says in verse 3. He says, I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received. What that means is that this gospel message wasn't new to the Apostle Paul. He had received it before. And another letter that historians agree, again, not Christian historians, skeptical historians, another letter that they agree was from the Apostle Paul, the letter of Galatians, has Paul's record that when he was first converted to Christianity, just a couple of years after the death of Jesus, he went away into Arabia. And after 3 years, he conferred with the apostles. And that's when Paul gets, so to speak, the gospel. Only 5 years after the death of Jesus and his appearance to his closest friends and followers. But we know that what he received had already been around, had already been put into a creed, might have even been put to music. And that makes what we read in 1 Corinthians 15, the creed in those verses 3 through 8, that makes that creed as early as 2 years after the death of Jesus and his appearance to his closest friends. Again, considering the 125 years from the life of Tiberius Caesar to the first historical record, it is a rock-solid fact of history that Jesus lived, that he died by crucifixion, and that he was seen by his closest followers after his death. Now, skeptics will debate what his closest friends were actually experiencing when they saw Jesus, but let me tell you this. Those men and women gave their life for the eyewitness testimony that Jesus had been raised by God from the dead. They would have known for a fact that they were lying if they said something different than what had happened. And so I will leave it up to you to decide whether or not the testimony of these hundreds of people who were willing to give their life was based on what they actually saw or not. The gospel is a matter of faith and fact. Point number two in 1 Corinthians 15, the gospel is a resurrection message. The gospel is a resurrection message. Listen to what it says in verses 20 to 23. In fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. The gospel is a resurrection message. Now we understand from verses 1 and 2 that this message is the message that the Corinthians had received, in which they stand, and by which they were being saved. It was not a message that saved them in the past. It was not a message only about something that had happened in the past. It was a message that was currently saving them. And it was a message, as we'll see in a little while, that allowed them to look to the future, to the living hope of the return of Jesus Christ. Now, it is right that the New Testament focuses a lot on the death of Jesus. We are saved because Jesus became like us in the flesh. He gave his life for us by dying on the cross. He shed his blood to cover our sins. And so it's right that the central symbol of the Christian faith is the symbol of the cross. But friends, it is not the symbol of the cross with a dead Savior upon it. It is the symbol of the empty cross, because Jesus is alive. Paul's argument here is that when Adam sinned, our first parents, Adam and Eve, when they disobeyed God, they brought sin and rebellion into the world. They brought sickness and death into the world. And when Jesus came in the flesh, he withstood even greater temptation as the second Adam, as our second representative. But he did not give in to the enemy's temptation. He lived the perfect life that we could never live, and that he gave his life on the cross to pay the price for sin that we should have to pay. But he did not stay dead. When he was raised from the dead, he buried death in his grave so that we could have new life in him. The gospel is a resurrection message. Have you ever noticed in the New Testament all the times that we're told to repent, to turn away from our sin, even to die to ourselves? Friends, this is not a message of death. We are told to die to ourselves so that in the same way that Jesus died on the cross and was raised by God from the dead, we might die to our sins and be raised in newness of life with him. We are told to die to ourselves, not to focus on death, but so that we can be welcomed into new life. You see, the Apostle Paul understands and emphasizes that if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, then our faith is worthless, because all we have is a dead Savior, a good example, a good moral teacher, even somebody who selflessly showed us how to give our life for somebody else. But we do not have a living hope. We do not have an ever-present help in time of trouble if Jesus stayed in the grave. He came up from the grave, and he is alive today. At this time, we live with a constant concern that somebody that we love, maybe our spouse, a parent, a friend, will get sick. We live with the constant concern that that sickness could lead to their death. Many of us have experienced living through that. We watched helplessly, like Lazarus's family, as a family member or a friend got sick and the sickness took them over and brought them down to death. When I was a child, I experienced this with my grandpa Doug, my mom's dad. My grandpa Doug was like a second father to me. My parents got married very young. My dad was 20, my mom was 19. By the time that my dad was 25 years old, he had 3 children and 3 jobs. He did whatever he had to do to take care of his family. But because my dad worked 3 jobs, I didn't get to see him as much as I would have liked to. And my grandpa Doug was always there. He would take me fishing. He would sit down and watch football and baseball games with me. He was a Cubs fan, so I became a Cubs fan. He was a Bears fan, so I became a Bears fan. My grandpa Doug was truly like a second dad to me. When I was 10 years old, we got the phone call that my grandpa Doug very suddenly and unexpectedly died. His funeral was one of the worst days of my life. I will never forget the aching grief in my heart at losing my grandpa Doug. Do you know what I did not have in the days after my grandpa Doug died? I did not have my grandpa Doug because he was dead. I didn't have him there to counsel me. 30 years have gone by where I haven't had my grandpa Doug to be able to ask him what he would do, to be able to laugh with him, to be able to enjoy things with him, to be able to receive his help because he died. He's gone. If Jesus didn't raise from the dead, then we are of all people to be pitied. If Jesus is not alive today, we do not have a risen Savior. We do not have a present help in time of trouble. We do not have Jesus if he did not raise from the dead. All we have is a memory. All we have is an example. And yet the Apostle Paul is so clear. This Savior is currently saving us. He is coming again to rescue us. Jesus is alive. It's a matter of faith. It's a matter of fact. It's the foundation of the gospel message. Number 3, the gospel is a living hope. Because Jesus is our living hope, his good news is a living hope. You know, I don't think there's ever been a time in my life that the scriptures that talk about the second coming of Jesus have been more alive to me than they are right now. I saw a news heading very early on in this crisis that said that people were fleeing to the deserts and the mountains. It was lifted right off the pages of Scripture. My wife and I have friends right now who have either been pregnant or they recently had a child, and we've talked about how difficult it must be to be a pregnant woman right now, to be having a baby right now, to be nursing a baby right now. And I'm reminded that Jesus said the same thing about the tribulation. Friends, we don't know for certain whether we're living in the last days, but we do know that Jesus told us to always be living as if we're in the last days. And I don't know about you, but this crisis has made the need for a living hope more clear to me than ever. If what we are living through right now isn't convincing you that you need a living hope, I don't know what could. Listen to the hope that the Apostle Paul tells us that we have in verses 50 to 57. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When this perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We are living in a time where for many it looks like death is winning. We are living in a time when people are stricken with fear and darkness. We are living in a time where we need a living hope, where we need to proclaim, oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Because Jesus buried death in his tomb when God raised him from the dead, and he is alive today, and he is coming again to rescue us from this mess. We are being saved if we stand firm in our faith and we look for the return of Jesus, our living hope. Jesus is our living hope. His gospel is a matter of faith and fact. His gospel is a resurrection message. His gospel is a living hope. Let's talk about two Easter takeaways today. Takeaway number one, apply facts to your faith. Apply facts to your faith. The reason that I went through that history lesson, I know many of you probably thought, Pastor Chad, we didn't tune into this Easter service to get a history lesson, to become some history scholar. Let me tell you why I walked through the history of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Because you will face things in your life. We are facing things in our life where we need to be reminded that Jesus came in history. He took on flesh. He demonstrated the love of God in an objective and tangible way. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. We need an external source outside of our feelings, outside of our intuitions, that reminds us that our faith is real. Friends, there are times when our faith is unquestionable. We are on the mountaintop. We feel victory is the wind in our sails. But for many right now, that is not how we feel. Our song is not a song of confidence. Our song is a song of doubt. Heartbreak has set in. Fear is creeping in. We are not going to get by in these times with an immature and emotion-driven faith. We need to apply the facts of the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus to our faith. We need to embolden our faith. We need to renew our mind with the reality that Jesus came and lived the perfect life that we could never live. He died on the cross to pay the price for sin that we should have to pay, demonstrating God's love for us no matter what we experience. And God raised him from the dead so that we could have new life in him. It's an objective fact of history. And when our faith is shaken, we need to look to Jesus as our living hope. We need to apply facts to our faith. The second takeaway is simply this. We need to attack fear with faith and hope. We need to attack fear with faith and hope. When fear starts to win, when we start to feel anxiety taken over, when we start to be overcome with doubt, when darkness begins to crowd out the light, we need to speak to our heart, to preach the message of the gospel, to renew our faith, to renew our hope in Jesus. As I was thinking about today's online service, as I was honestly heartbroken to not be able to gather for our Easter breakfast, to not be able to see the kids do the Easter egg hunt, to not be able to worship on Resurrection Sunday with my church family, I started thinking back to our Easter service last year when we celebrated with baptisms and we celebrated in song. And I remembered that I talked on that Easter a year ago about faith and fear. And I remembered a young artist named James who painted a wonderful painting and then painted over it, and how that was a wonderful object lesson to close our Easter service. Never in a million years did I think that we would face the overwhelming fear that we're facing right now. And I wanted to encourage you with a short video from last year's Easter service as we think about this second takeaway, attacking fear with faith and hope. Let this final part of the message encourage you from Easter's past and encourage you today in your faith journey with the living Lord. And we have many ways of dealing with our fear of death. As a church family, we've spent the last few months walking through the Gospel of Mark. And one of the common things we see in Mark are people's fearful reactions to the awesome power of Jesus or to terrifying events where Jesus intervenes and overcomes their fear. Jesus is portrayed in Mark as one who challenges us to choose faith in him over our fear. This past week, I asked a young artist in our church, James, to help depict for us what fear might look like. You see, the fear of death is what lies behind all of our other fears. It's in the background saying, you better not mess this up. You won't get another chance like this. You can't let them see who you really are. They will leave you, and you will never get them back. And so with the fear of death always looming in the background, we try to cover it up. We know it's there on the canvas of our lives, but we think that we can cover it with success or beauty or control or some pursuit of perfect health. We try and we try and we try to cover over the fear, that ticking clock that we all hear, the reality that the alarm could sound at any moment, the fear that when our time is up, we won't have grabbed enough of life, that we won't have amounted to what we wanted. Yet when Jesus went to the grave, he took death with him. He buried death in his grave. And when Jesus rose from the dead, he covered over our shame for his glory. Now, when we talk about the salvation that we're offered in Christ, we usually talk about the blood red color of Jesus' sacrifice for us. The Old Testament temple where people's sins were taken care of, were covered over, was a place radiating with color. In the book of Revelation in chapter 21, verses 18 through 26, we're told that the new Jerusalem will be filled with every kind of precious stone. It will be radiating in glorious color. But we can begin to experience the brilliance of life in living color with him if we cast aside the darkness of our fear and embrace the brilliance of a trusting faith in him. We can begin to see the radiance of his sacrifice and his power cover over our fears, and we can begin to grow more and more into the brilliance of his glory. Friends, I hope that that encouraged you today. Jesus is our living hope. The gospel is a message of faith and facts. The gospel is a resurrection message. The gospel, because Jesus is alive, is our living hope. Let us place all of our faith and trust today in our risen Savior, who came as the Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world, but was raised by God as the Lion of Judah, who will come again to rescue his bride. We look to him as our living hope. Today, join me as we close our Easter service, worshiping the Lion and the Lamb.
The Lord Almighty. Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb, and every knee will bow before Him. Open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who came to save is here to set the captives free. And who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before Him. And who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before.